Hello and welcome back to our educational video series exploring the analytical features of Microsoft's Enterprise Endpoint Security Platform, Defender for Endpoint. I'm Brian Donahue. I am a senior security specialist on the community team at Red Canary. This is the seventh installment, I think, in this video series. We've been releasing them so far in batches of three. To recap, at a high level, each batch of three is kind of built around an Atomic Red Team test. So Atomic Red Team is a library of sort of adversary simulations that are designed to emulate or simulate, I guess you could say, discrete adversary actions, like very small, I guess you could say, atomic actions. So all of those are mapped to MITRE ATT&CK. And then after we run that test on an endpoint, within each trio of videos, we dedicate one video to sort of triaging the native alerts that were generated, talking about how you can use Defender for Endpoint for investigations, what you should look for, et cetera. Second video, we go through response actions you can take after you receive those alerts using Defender for Endpoint. And then in the third video, we jump into Defender for Endpoint's advanced hunting console, and we talk about how you can build Kusto queries. Kusto is the query language in Defender for Endpoint. And then we close it out by talking about how you can use that advanced hunting console to stream data out of Defender for Endpoint and into another platform, whether that's something like a SIM or maybe it's something like Red Canary's security operations platform, where you're getting sort of added defense in depth via our, you know, additional detection analytics and also the expertise that comes from our detection engineering, incident handling, intelligence, and other teams at Red Canary. So, the tests we've covered so far were masquerading and scheduled task. As I noted in those other videos, the actions that we were taking in those tests weren't sort of directly malicious. Today, we're going to be running a test. Actually, today, I'm going to be running a test that is associated with a credential dumping technique called LSASS memory. So I'm not going to show this, but prior to recording this video, I jumped onto my virtual machine. I ran a test for LSASS in there. And the place this test actually came from is our threat detection report. So every year, we sort of take the MITRE ATT&CK mappings that are associated with all the confirmed threats that we see in our customer environments, and we create a list and write this very long report on it. So part of that report, though, is we write custom Atomic Red Team tests to be associated with the most prevalent techniques. So importantly, LSASS is one of the top 10. LSASS memory is one of the top 10 techniques we see every year. We created a test that uses run DLL32 to run a command that dumps LSASS into a file. So that file is going to contain a wide variety of credential material in it. So without wasting any further time, like I have been in the previous videos in this series, I'm joined by my colleague, Joe Savini. Joe is the principal solution specialist here at Red Canary. The solution he specializes in is Defender for Endpoint. So he's going to jump into Defender for Endpoint. The VM where I ran these tests has Defender for Endpoint on it. So he's going to jump into his admin console on Defender for Endpoint, and he's going to start looking for sort of the nefarious activity that I may have left behind on that endpoint. So off to you, Joe.
Thank you, Brian. So like Brian talked about, we have some suspicious activity here going on in PowerShell. I'm sure Brian has been up to no good, as he usually is. And so it is now our job to use Defender for Endpoint inside of the Microsoft Defender Security Center to just find out what he's been doing and try to get to the bottom of it in terms of triaging. So there's a couple different places we can start in Defender for Endpoint. We happen to know his device name. I feel like that's cheating. So perhaps we'll just pop over into the alert queue and see what's been going on over there. So we have a couple different alerts that jump out at us immediately, right? And when we look at them, they appear to be associated with the same desktop. We have a process memory dump. We see some LSASS, and then we get this great sort of mildly descriptive suspicious sequence of exploration activities. And all of these are associated, thankfully, with the same incident. So when we dive into an incident, it's actually going to have a roll-up view of everything that was associated. Defender, it does a great job of just correlating all of this information for us. Various alerts, various different categories of alerts, severities, and these incidents can actually grow to have multiple devices. Now, in this particular case, because we only have one device in this incident, we only see one device listed. And what we're going to do now is just kind of dive into some of these and find out what happened here in the alert story, and what can we expect when we see this type of activity occurring in Defender? So we have a couple different things when you dive into an incident view, or I'm sorry, an alert view. On the left-hand side, you have the alert story. And then on the right-hand side, you have some of this detail that is very specific to the alert itself. We're going to start with the alert story view and just kind of walk it down from origin to what actually occurred. Just at first glance, what you're going to notice is some of these lightning bolts, they're going to give you a really close view on exactly where some of the suspicious activity occurred. But, you know, with any other kind of triage, you always want to just step up one level and just understand the origin of the attack, what occurred that was so suspicious in the first place. So we see runtime broker, and you know, we know that runtime broker handles inspection of those Windows Universal apps. And it's a core process that it started in Windows 8. It's still here in Windows 10. We see PowerShell being a universal app being spawned by runtime broker. So that's not very suspicious, but part of PowerShell, when you start looking into it, just to make sure, hey, this is an attack. So let's make sure, is it an authentic version of PowerShell? This is looking like it is an authentic version of PowerShell. And it's also looking like it's being run with elevated privileges, which is something we need to keep in mind throughout the attack. The PE metadata is available, but because we already know that this is probably a legitimate version of PowerShell based on what it looks like, we don't need to worry about that metadata too much. This suspicious guy, we probably might want to see other stuff that he's been doing in the environment because something's a little weird with him. Now, we know that PowerShell, he must have had some kind of maybe an interactive session here. We can tell based on the inspection element that's highlighted here in Defender. So some of these are going to have gears if they're actually components or files or what have you. And then for some of these closer inspection elements, you're going to have, you'll see the icon change here. Now, this is data that's provided through AMSI. So AMSI is this interface that Microsoft has created in Windows to allow antivirus vendors. In this case, it happens to be themselves, but it actually will allow third parties to hook in there. And you can view all kinds of cool stuff inside of Windows that can be like a view into the script host, JavaScript, VB script, Office macros, and PowerShell. So what's really cool here is that AMSI has done a great job at actually giving us some insight into what's going on inside of PowerShell. And when we click on each of these AMSI scripts, we actually get some output of what was happening on PowerShell at that time. And if we walk this forward, we're going to eventually get to some of the suspicious activity that we see going on this host. Now, you don't have to be an AMSI expert or an expert in Defender for Endpoint to run through here and figure that kind of stuff out. What's awesome is that Microsoft's already done that for us. So when we jump down here into the alerts, we're going to get more and more context around some of the command line options that have actually occurred. So here we see that that command was actually parsed out of AMSI and brought down in here into the alert for us and included in some of that metadata. The reason that that's important is if you're exporting these alerts or bringing them places, some information isn't going to come from the alert story. So you're not going to get that full AMSI view. But because Microsoft has had the thought to say, hey, let's extract just the specific parts of these that people care about and incorporate them into that alert, it's going to make that data much more accessible to you in the future. So we can dive into here and get some additional context. We see that there was a Git process and all of these lightning bolts are actually associated with these different alerts that we see. So that's an important distinction to ensure, right? Just because we see four different alerts doesn't mean that there's four different alert stories. All of those alerts actually tie into the same alert story. And that alert story is the alert story that we see here. This is more of a timeline of activity that's occurred on the machine as represented by Defender for Endpoint. And when you start to click into these, the lightning bolts themselves represent the specific alerts that we saw. So we see these suspicious exploration, suspicious process discovery. And as you click on each of the alerts, you get a detailed context view on the right-hand side. We see in this case that these are endpoint detection and response alerts. And what that means is there's essentially a difference between whether or not something is going to be detected by the EDR component of Defender or going to be detected by the signature-based components of Defender. Both of them live on the machine and kind of work in a symbiotic relationship in order to expose like the bad stuff that's happening on the machine. But the way that they do that is completely and distinctly different. And so in this case, we can see EDR versus AV. We know that this is an EDR alert because it came from PowerShell, right? This is could be classified as a fileless attack. And when you have a fileless attack, it's going to be behavioral in nature. It's using those binaries that are already existing on the system kind of to perform some degree of malicious activity that's going to give the attacker some additional information. This becomes much more important when you go to respond. So from a triage perspective, whether a threat is signature-based or signature-less isn't really a big deal. But when you start thinking about it from a response perspective, which we're going to get into in a little bit in the next video, it's going to make a bigger deal. So it's going to give us a detection status, a category, some of the MITRE attack techniques, which you can actually click that'll link you right to the MITRE website. It's super convenient, as well as some, we'll call them more generic alert recommendations. And these apply to this alert as in respect to this machine. So some things you might want to think about there to just go through and make sure that you validated when you find those. But that's the basics in terms of triage here. Really, Microsoft does a great job of bringing it all together on the alert page, bringing it all together for the incident view. If you need additional information for triage and you need to go a little bit further back than they're giving you in the alert story, because you happen to find something that you think is interesting based on the indicators of compromise that have been provided to you, you can dive into that using the timeline view with a single click. But for this case, I think we have everything we need here right in the alert story that Microsoft has given us in order to find out exactly kind of what happened and what's suspicious and what kind of evil that Brian has been up to here.
All right. Thank you, Joe, for demonstrating my adversarial ineptitude there. Seriously, though, like one thing that I found super interesting here was that you were able to investigate some of that script content using, I guess I should say the alerts that came from Microsoft included script content that came from the anti-malware scan interface or AMSI. And I guess that's not super surprising in the context of Defender for Endpoint, since AMSI is a Microsoft thing. However, we've talked about this before in a lot of content, particularly in the threat detection report, and particularly as it relates to the inspection of PowerShell content and even like sort of interactive PowerShell content. So if you go back into those reports, like you'll see in there where we talk about like some EDRs inspect live PowerShell, like interactive PowerShell content. Some of them pull in AMSI data, some don't. I think like the tide is kind of changing on that and more EDRs are inspecting that data. But sort of an interesting call out here. So however, again, thanks, Joe, for going through this. As Joe just sort of alluded to there at the very end, the next part of this series is going to look at the response actions you can take to sort of resolve an incident that relates to these alerts. Of course, I've said this before, like the reason we're doing this for different kinds of attacks is because like depending on the threat you're dealing with, you may use different elements of response. And I think that in this next video, we're actually going to kind of diverge a little bit further from the response actions we did sort of in the scheduled task and masquerading ones. So again, thanks, Joe. Thanks everybody for watching. We're really looking forward to the next part of this video series where we'll be looking at the response actions that are available in Defender for Endpoint.